Hello, everyone. Julie Goodnight here for another Daily Dose of Horsemanship Homework, coming at you live today from my living room to your living room. And thanks for joining me. We are well into this COVID crisis, and we went from shutdown to stay at home, and now we're seemingly looking at the other side of this, and some of you are going back to work, some of you are still home. I'd love to know what your situation is. And as I posted earlier on Facebook, I think we'll have a good idea of how many people are back to work today, Monday, May 4th. And if you're back to work, you're probably not able to join me today for Facebook Live, but some of you I see are jumping online. Good morning, Megan. I know you're at work and fortunate to work from home, and also fortunate that you love horses, and so part of your job is to watch this Facebook post. So thanks for all you do, Megan. Good morning, Joan. Coming back from Northern California. Where have you been? And glad you could join us. So just gonna scroll through the comments as you guys pop online. Good morning, Patty from Longmont. We've got Ohio, Pennsylvania. Andrea, good morning. How's Denali behaving himself these days? I'm sure you'll let me know through the interactive program. Good morning, Michelle from Wisconsin. You've been on just about every single live post I've done, I think. And Elizabeth has too, even though she is working, I believe. Working from home, Liz? Yeah, working from home in sunny Virginia. Nice. Australia from Down Under. Sue, good morning. Thanks for joining us. Well, what? Good evening there? Good afternoon? Yesterday? I don't know. I can't keep track of that time zone. Good morning, Diana. Hope you had a great weekend. Diana's here to offer what customer service you need, technical support with our website, whatever you need. She is also receiving, taking orders over the phone, taking orders over the internet, shipping product every single day. So Diana, thanks for holding the fort down in our office. And Andrea's going to work from home through May. Well, good. Uh-oh. She's just saying that to make me keep going on this daily dose. I know how you are. I know you cannot get enough learning. And even though you're enrolled in the interactive program and doing all those assignments, you're also doing the daily doses. So, Andrea, here's my question for you. How much are you actually working from home? I'm just saying. Joan is tired, so you'll be here every day. Okay, life as usual, except trying to buy one home and sell another when you can't show homes. That's tough. Yeah, I've got some friends in the real estate business, and they were kind of shut down. Their offices were shut down late in the thing, and but now they're reopening again, starting to show houses and stuff. So hopefully, you'll be there soon. Forgot to check my phone for text messages. Hopefully it wasn't Megan texting me that this live isn't working. Good morning from Wyoming. We're getting high. We had high winds last night. I don't know about you, Terry. And they're forecasted for today, red flag warnings. Although I don't think it's super windy yet. So fingers crossed it will stay that way. Darren from Tennessee. I found that reading all the comments each day was as beneficial as the lessons. You gave us a unique opportunity to have a conversation. Yeah, that's the whole point, conversation. And fireside chat. Oh, wouldn't that be nice? Maybe I'll work on that for next winter. If not each day, I would love to continue this format at least once a week. Thank you again for sharing this. Well, Darren, I really appreciate those comments, and they could not be more apropos, because that's what I was thinking too, that we could do this once a week, that we could, I don't know, I'll have to look into, or more importantly, Megan will look into the technology that we need to accomplish this in a live format. I'd like to look at possibly doing it on a different venue where people can participate, where we can turn their audio live to ask a question, and then maybe doing that live once a week is what I was thinking. So I don't know. We'll see. I was thinking Wednesday might be a good day for that. So thanks, Darren. I appreciate that. Helps me out a lot. I know what you guys are thinking. Good morning, Deanne and Valerie from Washington. Andy, North Carolina. Again, yeah, been joining us almost every post. Still at home, but supposed to be opening this Friday in three stages. That's kind of where we are here in Colorado. We had our first stage of the reawakening on Monday. I heard a talking head this morning say that that rebooting the economy was not like inflating a low tire. It was like having a tire completely flat to the rim on your car and only a bicycle pump to blow it up. And so we are starting slowly. The restaurants and the like aren't open yet. And I don't think we'll be till the middle of the month. I've sort of lost track on what's what, because I'm just focusing on my events. My first event is not until the end of May, May 28th. So just got fingers crossed that that comes off without a hitch. I know there's about 21 people registered for that program at See Lazy U. If any of you are busting out of the seams and ready to get back on the road and want an incredible luxury instructional vacation, the Women's Wholeness and Riding Retreat that I co-teach with Barbara Schulte is coming up May 28th at the See Lazy U Ranch, and it will be as they are looking at reopening. So looking forward to that. Good morning from Caroline. How are you speaking of See Lazy U? And Caroline's here. And Littleton and Northern California. Two, so that makes two of you. Good morning from Oregon, Florida. Did my yoga. All right, Caroline. I'm glad you're warmed up. Today's lesson, by the way, I should mention, I'll try to get through the scroll here momentarily. Today's lesson is, I just picked a few fun stretches and core balancing exercise, three of each. So we'll do three stretching kind of exercises, and then we'll do three core balance exercises. And I just want to talk to you about how they relate to riding. And I think you'll find these are my very favorite exercises. And I deliberately did not pick any of them were difficult to do, because I know some of you, all of us are in various states of flexibility and condition and how much strength you have in your core. So you will of course only do what you can but you might, even if you alter it to fit your needs or to fit your limitations, you'll still be able to understand why this relates to riding. So if you are able to ride, you're probably going to be able to do these exercises. So I'll get through the scroll and remind myself to be drinking water. Okay. I'll get through the scroll and then we'll start on the lessons. So Patricia from California, Andrea, had a good trail ride. Good. Old Denali's doing well. He's growing up and growing a brain, isn't he? And then you have been working very diligently through the interactive program and everything else you can get your hands on to get somewhere with that horse. So good for you. Hello from rainy Kansas. We would take some rain. I'm telling you, it's dry, dry, dry here. Mark, still at home. Sue, thanks for commenting on my podcast. You know, I've been doing a monthly podcast for a long, long time. All of those podcasts are listenable from my website. Just go to juliegoodnight.com/podcast. Or you can pick them up on any platform that you listen to podcasts on, Apple, iTunes, Google, whatever. If you're using a podcast platform and we aren't on it, just let us know. We'll make sure the podcast appears there too. But you can find it on my website, and I've been doing it for years. And so actually, they're not all up there from the beginning of when I've been doing it, but the last few years worth are. And they're titled so that you can understand the primary content. But in all of my podcasts, I do a Q&A, much like this, except for it's audio, not video. And I'm answering your real question. So even though the title of the podcast may say, you know, building confidence at the canter, the Q&A portion could have information on, you know, what have you, groundwork, behavior, anything you ask. Anything you ask, I'll answer. So, hi from sunny South Carolina. Nice. A teacher taking a lunch break. Oh, good. Oh, before your next Zoom class. Very cool. So, you know, let's know, Sue, or let's see. Linda, do you think when we extend this into permanent situation and it's a 1 day a week live broadcast, would Zoom be a good platform for that? Okay. And also, sunny South Carolina reminds me, I may be coming back to Myrtle Beach this fall in November for the American Heart Association Beach Ride. We are working on a brand new campaign. I am working on a campaign with the American Heart Association. It's their campaign, actually, to bring awareness that pets and horses and horseback riding are a part of a healthy lifestyle. And the American Heart Association Beach Ride is in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, every year in November. 1,200 horses, 2,000 people converge on this giant campground on the beach, and they camp with their horses for 5 days, and they get to ride on the beach all that time. It's the only time of the year where horses are allowed on the beach there. And it is one of the American Heart Association's big fundraisers, certainly one of the top in South Carolina. And anyway, I love participating in that event. It's an incredible cause. Heart disease affects so many people. And did you know that 80% of heart disease is entirely preventable? So it's the American Heart Association's mission through research and public awareness campaigns to reduce death from heart disease and stroke in the United States. So it's a good cause. And fingers crossed that I'm going to make it to Myrtle Beach again this year for that event. So, Soundpoint, Idaho, glad you guys are back online. Let's see, we got 89 people, so a little less, but, you know, of course, all along, people have needed to go back to work. Oh, Twyla, I miss you come online, but I'm going to get through your guys' conversation. Iowa, good morning. I brought your cantering with confidence and I cantered for the first time. Woohoo! I dialed her number and did it. Good job. Even used the analogy I use of dialing the horse's number before you cue him to canter. So excellent job, Lori. And thanks for mentioning the Canter with Confidence DVD. It is, it's no longer a DVD. It's only available streaming from my website. It is my number one selling training video, and it is an A to Z video on the canter, starting from scratch and ending up in flying lead changes, and including the understanding the mechanics of the gait, how you ride the canter, how you cue for the canter, how you control the canter, how you slow down the canter, how you do lead changes, simple and flying, and a few other things in between. It's almost, or I believe it's about a 2-hour training video, and that is available on streaming on my website. So check that out. I'm sure Diana will throw a link up for you. And is that two people now from Australia, or is this, it's the same person, I think, from Victoria, Australia, and it's close to today. Well, what in the world are you doing awake? That's my question. You are an insomniac, maybe, or maybe you work at night. But all throughout my 11 years of a TV program on RFD TV, my show would re-air in the middle of the night several times a week. And so people would tell me all the time that they would wake up in the middle of the night and couldn't sleep, so they'd watch my show. And as if I should take that as a compliment. But it was funny because sometimes the husband or the spouse, let's just say the spouse of the person watching the show, would say, you know, sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night and I hear your voice. And I knew they were an insomniac watching my TV program on training horses in the middle of the night. So, okay, you guys. There's a platform to check out. Cool. Thanks, Suze. I should know. You would know the answer to that question. So we'll look into that. Nancy, thank you. And you have learned a lot, but you already know a lot. So that's a pretty big compliment. So thank you. Hello, Susan. Yolanda, I appreciate your lesson on bending, leading to disengage the hip. Bending, leading. Oh. Bending, leading to disengage. I'm thinking leading the horse. I'm thinking bending on the horse, and then I'm thinking leading the horse, going, what the heck? So I get now. So that was the three-step circling. Starts with the horse flexing in the pole, then flexing in the shoulder, and then disengaging the hindquarters. Super, super valuable, easy lesson to do. Do it. It's a slow maneuver at the walk. And really almost any level rider can do it. And it's what I used to do in clinics all the time. I've kind of gotten away from doing it in clinics or only as it comes up. Not because it's not a great exercise, but because I learned so much every year about horses and teaching riding that I'm always bringing new stuff in. And sometimes when I go back and I look at the older stuff I did, I go, God, I got to keep doing that. Just because it's older does not mean it's less good. And so much of what we teach in horsemanship goes back thousands of years, thousands, lots of it, most of it, really. Okay. Okay, finish the question, Julie. Actually had to use it on my young saddlebred. Keep it forward while riding in the pasture. Big confidence boost for me and perhaps rally to check for him. Good job. Okay, keep in mind, I also did a lesson on the pulley rein, which is the emergency stop. And there's an important thing to distinguish here, and that is that disengaging the hindquarters or the one rein stop, which this exercise leads up to, but is valuable to do the whole thing, the bending part of it. Disengagement of the hindquarters, the one rein stop, is a valuable tool up until the horse is running away with you. You would never, ever, ever do the one rein stop with a horse running away with you, because you would just throw him to the ground, likely. And so what we do instead with a horse that is already bolting, he's already in a dead run straight ahead, his neck is stiff as a freight train, you want to do the pulley rein. And that is a variation of the one rein stop, which is not easy to accomplish, but when you learn how to do it, and one of the daily doses is on that, I'm sure Megan can throw up a link to that daily dose on the pulley rein. Once you learn how to execute that, you can stop a runaway horse pretty handily. And that is very confidence inspiring. But the one rein, but the pulley rein, because of the way you do the reins and you fix the horse's nose in front of him, you lock it in front of him and then pull on one rein, the horse will not turn. And the leverage generated in that move will bring him promptly to a stop. So those are two tools, both of which give you confidence. Now, the three-step circling is a ongoing everyday thing you're going to do because it also has a mental or a calming effect. So when people ask me for calming exercises, I go right to the three-step circling. So thanks for that feedback, Yolanda. Again, always helpful. Always, it's always good to know for instructors what was valuable for you to learn and why, because it helps us teach it better and bring more meaning to the lesson. Here's the link to these you. Hello, Clayton. and Linda from England joining us again. Thanks for being there in the evening. And greetings from Fruta on the western slope of Colorado. I did hear a new story that you guys lost a lot of the fruit crop this year, and I'm so sad for you guys and for us guys that eat that fruit. That's the best peaches in the world. Missing my Tai Chi. Oh, great exercise. And I think I've maybe done one Tai Chi, but I've done some similar martial arts a few times, enough to know that focus and concentration and balance and energy flow is so applicable to riding. So I don't know what you think about Tai Chi, and I know there's a lot of balance involved there too, but I'd be curious to hear your take on that. So, I'm on a lunch break in Augusta, Georgia at the VA hospital. Wow, it's frontline worker probably. Colorado, Northern Colorado, Pennsylvania. There's a link to the podcast. Caroline says, best book ever at Sea Lazy U. Where else do you get this kind of expertise at your fingertips, not only in the arena from Julie and Barb and their fantastic team, but also at breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and cocktail hour, of course. Yeah, that's kind of how it goes. We eat, breathe, and learn about horses all week long, and ourselves, because this particular retreat has a lot of confidence building, personal empowerment, and Barbara Schulte is so fabulous at life coaching skills and all that kind of stuff. So it's fun. We start out the morning with sort of an short inspirational session. Then I do a little short riding or something like this we're about to do. And then we go out and ride all morning. And then we come back at lunch and we talk about it. And then we go back out and ride some more. And then we kind of do the whole thing in the evening again. So it's fabulous. I've got clinics 4 times a year, by the way, and each of them are a different program. Some of you are signed up for the Horsemanship Immersion Program because you are an insatiable learner. And so if you aren't able to travel at the end of May this year, check out the 3 clinics I have at Sea Lazy U in the fall. Also, I'm happy to come wherever you are to do a clinic whenever I can fit it into my schedule, because I have a lot of time to make up for now. Hello from Chile, Michigan. It's warm and sunny here. New York. I haven't missed anything, and I haven't started the lesson yet, and I got to get going on this thing because I'm already 23 minutes in. That's good. What's the best way to start riding a horse after a long winter break? I could give you 100 answers based on the horse. If it is a well-trained, obedient horse, and you haven't ridden it since the fall, he's still the exact same well-trained, obedient horse that he was. Actually, I'm going to defer to one of my podcasts or articles, because I've recently, I believe, both written and done a podcast. Plus, we've talked about it on the Daily Doses, I believe. But I would, you know, if he were a lesser trained horse, I would probably start with just getting him out, tying him up, grooming him, handling his feet. Seeing how much reminding of his manners or reminding of this is the way we do stuff he requires. Maybe he's a young horse. Maybe he was just started in training last fall. I don't know. There's so many questions I can't say exactly. But it would range anywhere from just getting that horse out initially on the first day and tying him up, handling him a little bit, seeing where his focus is, seeing if he would listen to me, stand quietly, accept my, do the skills we did before. But it's always going to be a process of thinking about where you were when you left off, and then just checking all of that off to make sure it's still there. You might find, yeah, he's fine here, he's fine here, and he's fine here, but we need a little reminder of this, but he's fine here. So do whatever reminders the horse requires. But if nothing has changed but a few months off because of winter riding, then it's and he's a well-trained, experienced horse that you know well, then just getting him out, maybe do, you know, 5 minutes of groundwork to check in with, get up and ride. Certainly for my horses, I just get them out, saddle them, ride. But they are very well-trained horses and very experienced, and I am very strict about my expectations of the way they act, and so they've never really had much opportunity to act poorly. So that's a whole different horse than that young, green, untrained, spoiled, bound. Certainly if the horse has been turned out all winter in a herd with very little interaction, handling in and out and all that, he, even a trained horse, might be herd bound. But in that checking off or that checking out, that's what I'd be looking for, is how freaked out is he about leaving anybody behind and all of that. If he were very emotional about that, I would then start a campaign of groundwork until I got that in check. And that might take 10 minutes or a few days. I don't know. Maybe it'll take you a week. So that's a general idea. And again, let's throw up some resources that talks about coming back after winter break. 'Tis the time of year that we talk about that a lot. Okay, great. These are social. Thank you, thank you. Northern Minnesota. Should I be getting close to the bottom? I need a. Do you think I need a round pen and horses? Can I do it without a round pen or crown? You know, to me, just to give you a short answer. You know, a round pen is a very valuable resource for a horse facility. And for a horse trainer, it's invaluable, really. However, a good round pen is expensive to build because it has to be very solid. You have to use, if you use corral panels, you have to use the heavy, strong, horse safe panels. They have to be well anchored. You have to have a solid, strong body to keep the horse's legs out of those panels. And then you have to build footing in there that is safe. And that's expensive too. To just buy, you know, 12 foot corral panels or whatever it takes to make a 60 foot circle and throw in a couple of T-posts is not a safe round pen, and don't waste your money on it. There's ways to train horses. There's plenty of ways to train horses without round pens. But if you have access to a good, safe round pen, it's a valuable tool in training. But I will tell you this, if you're just training one horse and if you do things right, you only temporarily need the round pen. So if I'm starting a colt, which I have a video on, it's called First Ride, and it takes you through my process, all the way through the first few rides from zero training, saddle training, to the first few rides. If you follow that process, the round pin would be very valuable. But for me, training one horse, I would probably only use that round pin for 2 or 3 weeks. And once I got that horse working outside the round pin, I probably am not going to bring him back there again. Maybe ever, because my training is just going to continue to progress. And I like to tell people when I'm doing round pen demonstrations, and I believe it's in my round pen video as well, that when you do this right, it's a temporary place, round pen. It's a place of rudimentary establishment of a relationship and your authority and leadership. Then we end the round pen process by developing a very intricate line of communication between you and your horse, and with that horse very visibly and with his heart accepting your authority and leadership. Once that occurs, and generally that part of it is going to occur for me within the first week of training. For a non-pro person working a horse, you know, it might be 2 or 3 weeks. And then I'm going to have the horse saddle broke and ride outside the round pen within the next couple of weeks. So then I'm done with the round pen, unless you have another horse coming along for training. So those would be your considerations, whether or not it's worth it for you to buy a round pen. Even just buying cheap panels, which are unsafe for horses. If they have a gap between the panels, they are unsafe for horses. And if they're lightweight, I guarantee a horse is going to get his legs tangled up in those corral panels, and they're going to look like spaghetti, and the horse is going to fall down, collapse them or pull them out or something. So it is not, and that's not cheap. To build a round pen out of that is still not cheap. So I would not invest the money unless you can do it right and unless you're going to have a lot of training going on. Now, look, for people like me or trainers that own multiple horses or that they need, we're getting ready to build a 100-foot round pen for riding horses and for loping, a loping arena, basically, at working cattle. And so... yes, they're valuable, but only it's going to get a lot of use, I would say. And you have the money to do right. Happy to see you too from Wisconsin. This is okay. The three step. Thanks, Leanne. Make it happen. You know, I know a lot of you guys have tried to get into the CLAZD programs and been told it's full, it's full, it's full. We'll put you on the waiting list, and you never hear from them. Because those spots don't open up. But now all clinics have openings at CLAZU. Not because people have canceled, but because the fall clinics haven't filled up yet. And invariably there will probably be people that were signed up that may have to cancel. So contact the CLAZU ranch and make it happen. You can do this. So any tips on a mare that always grunts, squeals, and strikes out when riding with other horses? Yes. She's not in heat either. She's usually quiet during that time of month. Okay, not often that people wish their mares were heat more. Look, you have a mare problem, and you have a big horning problem. Horses of all ages and genders must be trained a very, very, very important manner, and that is that when you are being ridden or handled but from the ground, zero interaction with other horses is allowed, because what your horse is doing is highly dangerous and people can get hurt, and FYI, people can get killed. I mean, that's true because I've personally witnessed. So look, horses are excellent at distinguishing when they can act that way and when they cannot. They're as good at this probably as humans are. When you explain the rules to them and you consistently enforce the rules and you apply appropriate punishment for this egregious break of the rules, then this behavior is easily eliminated. It should be started with foals at the youngest age. I don't mean baby little foals that are tender little things, but certainly by the time they're weanlings. And if you get a horse that's 10 years old and he has not learned that rule, you better teach it to him forcefully in no uncertain terms, because this is first and foremost a safety rule. I have very high expectation of my horses, which is that they do not interact with other horses when they're being handled. And I punish them when they do consistently so that they know they're not supposed to. Go to a rodeo sometime and you'll see, I'm not kidding, 75, 80 horses tied up along a fence, stallions, mares, and geldings, and they are not even looking at each other. There's, you know, 10 inches of space at that between them, and they're not even looking at each other. It's because they're trained. And if we allow horses to act the way horses act on their own time while we're riding them, somebody's going to get in the middle of that interaction and get hurt. They're going to fall off. They're going to get their leg broke. They're going to, you know, get a head injury, whatever. So this is a very important rule. I've written a lot about this. I've talked a lot about it. I'm certain there's videos on my website about it. I'm pretty sure the podcast is heavily laden with this subject. And so I'm not going to get too far into how you fix this problem. But it stems from poor handling, because it shouldn't have been a problem to begin with if the horse was trained right. So it may just be a gap in the horse's education, and you need to fill it. And so that's just a simple basic safety rule that you cannot participate in a group of horses. And I like to tell people that have horses that act like that, my horse is not allowed to react to what your horse does in any way, shape, or form. And if he does, I will punish my horse for something you allowed your horse to do. But I have such high expectations of my horse's behavior that I know I must follow through, even when it seems, you know, that he should really, justified for my horse to act that way. So get that fixed. It's a dangerous, dangerous behavior. Always enforce this very strict rule. Once I am around you, either on the ground or in the saddle, zero interaction with other horses is allowed, friendly or not friendly. No gestures, no showing of the teeth, no flicking of the ears, no turning the hip. None of that is allowed, and it will be met with the harshest penalty should you forget. And horses are so good at learning stuff in no time at all. With the right training, this horse would be safe and pleasant to be around on a trail ride with. So remember, squealing is an audible threat that I'm about to kick your butt. So I would scold that horse so hard that she would never think about doing it again, to be honest, because I would fix it right away. I know the seriousness of the problem. Hello from Alaska. Good, 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 Uli. Hello. Also, a very familiar with Sea Lazy U. Ginny, hi. She's maybe a teacher taking another break from remote learning. And thanks for the post. Okay. Checklist of those things to review. Look, I've done all that. A lot of these questions you guys are answering, I've already answered numerous times, and all that information from 30 years of my career is on my website. And not all of it is on the free side of my website, but all of it's on the paid side. And we will make sure that there are these answers, but I believe, in my blog, in my newsletter, I'm sorry, in my blog and in my podcast, in the last few months, these questions have been very thoroughly answered. And I know I did a checklist at some point. So check that out. Wisconsin, North Carolina. Tony, what is your thought about riding in mud? Same with slide. My horse, after hears of working it, still has to have discussions to go through mud sometimes. I hate when my knees hit the trees. That is a bummer. Okay, so what is your thought about riding in mud? Well, it depends on the mud. So the things that I'm really worried about riding my horse in, that I don't take a chance on having soft tissue injuries, are slippery mud, like clay type, where they're going to be on terrain that's hilly and they're going to slip and slide. Deep mud has a suction quality that has a boggy type quality to it. Don't want my horse in that. But it's good footing. Like, let's say you're in an area where it's been pouring down rain and there's standing water in the arena, but it's good non-slippery footing under there. I have no qualms about riding in the mud. I don't have qualms about riding in the wet. It's just about the slipping factor. And just because they're going to go, and then when that leg slips out from under them, they might pull a tendon or do something. And I don't want that to happen. Also, when they bog down in stuff and then have to pull up to get out, not only going to pull a shoe, he's going to pull a muscle, pull a tendon or something like that. So it's not worth it to me. But if it's just splashing around, getting dirty, but he's got a good gripping surface and a good cushion, I love the mud. And look, I rode on the racetrack all the way through college. And even though it was in New Mexico where we didn't get mud much, I loved a wet track. It was kind of fun. And I grew up in Florida and riding jumping horses. And we jumped all the time in wet arenas with standing water in them. But they had really good, solid footing. And that was just a part of the contest, was that how well did your horse negotiate that footing? So just make sure it's safe. No problem with mud and wet. Okay. Here's working in the mud. Still. So look, if you have a horse that is fearful of going into muddy situations on the trail, that horse has probably at some point gotten stuck or hung up in a log. And, you know, there are places in the trail, I don't know about where you are, but here in the Rocky Mountains, there you come upon places on the trail in the mountains where water, let's say there's a little spring up above and it's created a flat place in the trail. And over the years, it turns into a sort of bottomless bog. And then when the horse steps in it, he goes clear up to his hocks, clear up to his knees or elbows, and then he's stuck there. And the straining and the fear, that claustrophobia, all of that is very frightening to the horse. So if you're not dealing with a simple obedience problem, and it's only a fear of mud, what he's probably afraid of is box. And look, also in Colorado and New Mexico, we have quicksand, and quicksand kills horses. I've seen horses stuck in quicksand. We all were able to get them out, but I know people that said they've had situations where they didn't get the horse out, or they found dead horses in quicksand. And so they're not very well built to sustain that kind of stuff. So they just sink down in it and then they can't get up. So, you know, keep that in mind. Don't ask your horse to go someplace. If you ask your horse to go someplace like that, and as a result of it, he gets hurt, he'll never trust you again, and he shouldn't. So I don't know if that's what you're dealing with. If it's a simple obedience problem, you're probably having this problem in many places. Maybe not many, but in other places where if he thinks it's optional whether or not he goes or not, there will be places where he decides to take that option and not go. So that's just an obedience problem, and that you have to go back and fix, you know, over time. Hello? And green horse, never had to deal with that before. Okay, well, if that's coming back after a long hiatus, then you're probably just starting over from scratch. I would go through the same training progression that you used last year. Do not move on to the next step until that feels fully refreshed. But as soon as it feels fully refreshed, move on. You might be able to move through the steps pretty rapidly. Welcome from Oklahoma. Oh, by the way, today my blog is coming out. My newsletter is coming out. If you are not signed up for my twice a month email newsletter, you should go to my website now, or Diana will throw up a link where you can sign up for my newsletter. And my blog comes out the first month, and my podcast comes out in the middle of the month, and the newsletter gives you those things. So this month's blog is about my new foster training project, and I'm going to introduce you to this four-year-old gelding that I am taking in foster training so that he can have a successful life with some lucky person that's going to be able to adopt this colt. And I'm going to introduce him to you in my blog today. We're going to have pictures, maybe even some video if we get that done. And I will hopefully get that released today. I'm still putting some finishing touches on the article. And right after my live post today, I'm going to finish that. So by late this afternoon or first thing in the morning, we should have the newsletter out to you with the blog that tells you about my new foster training project. And Oklahoma reminded me of that because this horse is coming to me from Oklahoma City and the regional support center there that is an operation that helps horses in need. Basically, whatever they need, they find it and they help. And Gunner is actually, Doc Gunner is Colt's name. And he is the 101st horse they've brought into a safer situation and into the adoption pipeline. So that's later today. Any advice from Merit School? I did that a lot. Okay, Melanie French, hello. And from Kansas, I thought quicksand, which is something in the Princess Bride. You know, I did too. I do have quicksand in Florida as well, which is where I grew up. I think it can occur any place where there's sort of bottomless sand. And that it has something to do with, I don't know, this is just all my guesstimation, but or stuff I've heard. It has to do with sort of underground water flows and then this huge sandy, you know, column sort of comes down and washes out or whatever. I don't know. But I've seen it and I've been in it and it kills horses. So do bogs. And so that is why horses have a mortal fear of that kind of stuff. So that's what you're dealing with is an instinctive. Okay, made it to the bottom. Now it's time for our exercise. So what I need you to do, you've got on comfy clothes, I hope. You're in your living room. You got a mat on the floor if you need it, or just a soft floor. You don't want to be doing this on a hard floor. You need, you know, throw a towel, blanket down, yoga mat. Remember, you're just going to do this to your ability. Keep in mind your physical limitations, any injuries that you might have. I actually have a bad knee, and one of these exercises I'm going to show you, I can't completely execute it. Megan, and I wish we could see her because I can't quite bend my knee that way, but I will show you how you can do it if you are incredibly flexible. So just do it to your ability level. But as I talk about how this relates to riding, it will help if you're at least in the position and at least putting some effort into trying this. And by the way, I might not be able to see you, but I will know if you actually tried this stuff by your comments and questions. And so get down on the floor, get your mat. If you need to put it on pause or whatever to go get your mat and get ready for this, do that now. And I'm going to just move back away from the camera a little bit here. And we're going to start with some stretches. Now, there's a couple of things I have to tell you about Pilates that are sort of foundational that we want to do in every single exercise. And the first is your breathing. So if you can just sit in a chair, sit on the ground, and think about sitting up nice and tall, think about an elongated spinal column. Think about lengthening from the back of your head. Think about your shoulder blades being flat on your back, your abdominal muscles engaged, sort of sucked up into your ribs, your belly button is in, slight roundedness to your lower back. So you've got a perfectly vertical spinal column. And then we like to imagine a marionette string coming off the top of your head and lengthening and stacking that spinal column, one vertebrae on top of the other in a perfectly plumb vertical line. So if we talk about the marionette string, it's referring to that plumb line of your spine. We talk about engaging the abdominal muscles. We're sort of just shortening in the front here, pulling your abdominals up into your rib cage. Your belly button sort of comes in a little bit at that time, and you feel a little bit of roundedness to your back. That's straightening your spine in the lower portion. And so then when we talk about our breathing, the breathing is always a really important part of the exercise. We always breathe in and then breathe out, of course. And but you want to breathe in through your nose and out softly through your mouth in a slow count of 10. So let's just try that breathing portion and the marionette string. So go ahead and imagine your marionette string, get long and tall in your spinal column, and then you're gonna inhale 2, 3, 4, 5, and blow out softly through the mouth as you exhale 2, 3, 4, 5. In, 3, 4, 5, and out 2, 3, 4, 5. So that. You want to utilize your breathing in the exercises, and we, you know, if for the most part, you're breathing out during the point of exertion in the exercise. So then also one more thing for you to understand when we do these Pilates exercise is when we use the term Pilates stance, what we're referring to then is your legs and your seat. And so Pilates stance would mean, let's get over here on the mat so you can see a little better, would mean that you're standing with your heels together and your legs zipped together all the way up, your abdominal muscles engage so that your tailbone is tucked under. So Pilates stance is with your legs together and straight and zipped all the way up. So with that concept in mind, I'm gonna show you three stretches and three fun little exercises. And so in this first exercise, you are going to put your heels at the base of the mat, heels together, legs together, and lay down flat on the mat. And we're going to roll up as if you're gonna, as you come up and stretch forward, I want you to stretch, don't reach for your toes, but stretch forward. Keep your arm next to your ears. And imagine that there's a beach ball right inside here so that your abdominals and back is very rounded in this exercise. Okay, so we're going to start laying down on the floor with your hands back behind you. Make sure you're just softly point your toes. Your abdominal muscles are engaged. Your rib muscles are engaged. And we're just going to go, as you inhale, bring your chin to your chest. Roll up, belly button in, and reach forward and stretch. And then exhale as you stretch, it should feel really good. And now inhale as you suck that belly button in, chin to chest, roll all the way down to the ground, one vertebrae at a time, and finish with your hand back. Again, inhale, chin to chest, roll forward, keep your arms up by your ears. Imagine that beach ball in the middle, and let's just try that a few more times. So roll down one vertebrae at a time, toes pointed, legs zipped together, and inhale, chin to chest, and roll, reach forward. And you inhale, suck your belly button in as you roll down one vertebrae at a time. You're squeezing your thighs, your abdominal muscles, together, so your legs are up together. You're using your legs as you roll up one vertebrae at a time. Use your legs, toes pointed, legs straight, to sort of counter lever a little bit, help you pull up. So try that for me. It's very difficult for me to teach and do it at the same time, but I want you to do it a couple of more times. And I want you to think, imagine as you're rolling yourself up one vertebrae at a time, that you're on a horse and maybe you got thrown off balance momentarily, or you got left behind and you've got to pull yourself back up to that seated position. So if that is a little bit too much for you to do that much of a sit-up, Let me show you a variation you can do of the same exercise. This is sort of a preparation exercise. So my feet are about shoulder width apart, my knees bent. I'm going to put my hands behind my knees and my arms at my side. And I'm going to do I'm going to roll back in the same way until my arms are straight. And then I'm going to bring myself up, sitting up straight without pulling with my arms, but only using my core. So it looks like this, sitting up tall. I'm going to inhale, chin to chest, and row back until my arms are straight. And then as I exhale, one vertebrae at a time, I'm going to come all the way back up to the sitting tall position. So inhale, chin to chest, round through your belly button, all the way back until your arms are straight. And then bring yourself all the way back up, one vertebrae at a time, until you're sitting up straight again. Try not to use your arms unless you have to. And so both of these exercises are roll-up exercises and roll-down exercises. And they're really important for developing that core strength that you use in riding. So this motion of bringing yourself back upright, it happens in riding all the time. And so this is really part of having that very secure seat, being able to change your balance with the horse easily, and being able to regain your balance. So I'm going to show you another variation of that same exercise, which should feel even better. I know some of these are a little bit sit-up-like, but it's the stretch you get after the sit-up that's really fabulous. So for this one, I want you to place your feet at the end of the mat, shoulder width apart, with your feet flexed. I want to keep your feet flexed, your legs straight and strong, so these muscles are all engaged. And now we're going to basically do the same kind of roll up. It's a little bit more difficult to do this one, but after you lay down, you're going to come up and reach forward, not down to your feet, but just reach forward, arms level with your ears, and you'll feel a really nice stretch all the way through here. And then we'll get the roll down and roll up, strengthening and balancing that occurs in the abdominals. So lay down flat, make sure you engage your abdominals, suck your belly button in, your back is flat, and your hands are up by your ears. So you're gonna inhale in the chest and push through your heels with your feet flexed, and reach as you exhale. And then as you inhale, suck that belly button back in. Slowly roll down one vertebrae at a time. Exhale as your arms come back. Again, inhale, chin to chest, and reach all the way forward as you lengthen. Feel that stretch all the way through the backside of your body. And inhale, suck that belly button in. Round down slowly and with control, using your abdominal strength to control as you come all the way back. As you exhale, one time, inhale, come up, stretch and lengthen through your flexed feet, and go back down. Now, I'm going to teach, and you can try that a few more times. I really love these first few stretches I've shown you. I would do them six to 10 times if you can. And really focus on one of the great things about Pilates that relates it to riding is that you learn control of individual abdominal muscles, whether that be in a twisting or by using your legs or by rolling up and down like you're doing this time. So it teaches you to isolate and strengthen those abdominal muscles, and more importantly, how to coordinate all of those muscles, abdominal muscles, and including your leg muscles and buttocks muscles, and even what's going on with your upper body, how we coordinate all those muscles and all that strength to be able to move fluidly with the horse, stay in balance with the horse, and ride to a higher level. So, okay, so that was the spine stretch forward. One more stretch I'm going to show you, and then we'll go on to the fun stuff, and that is the saw. Now, many of you have done this kind of exercise before. It's nothing unique to Pilates in any way. But I want to talk to you about how I see this exercise connecting to your riding. So, take a little drink of water. And now you're going to push back to the middle of your mat. Spread your feet a little bit more than shoulder apart. And a little bit more than the width of your mat. I want you to take a moment to center yourself, sit nice and tall, imagine the marionette string, suck that belly button in and engage the upper abdominal muscles up into your rib cage, and make sure all of your weight is equally on your two seat bones here, and your lower back is flat and relaxed. Feet are flexed, and this is important because one thing I want you to connect with this exercise is how you get more weight in your heels, and how, as we stretch and flex, I want you to be pushing through your heel here and lengthening the backside of your leg, because we all know how important it is to have your heels down in riding, and it is because it causes an energy flow to move down through your heel and dissipate. If you do not stay weighted in your heels and you instead are weighted on the stirrup, that energy flow is disrupted. The absorption, the energy flow is disrupted. And so you bounce off the horse instead of stay secure down on him as he moves. So sitting nice and tall, feet flexed, legs straight, imagine that marionette string. And I want you to place your arms out to your side, nice and straight. Make sure your shoulder blades are flat on your back. And take a deep breath in. And I want you to twist to one direction as far as you can. And then exhale. And then exhale as you reach down to your little toe. And just imagine you're sawing off your little toe. And then inhale and come back to center. Go at your own pace, and you're going to inhale, twist, and then saw, and then inhale as you come back up and twist. And I'm going to do it along with you, but I want you to go at your own pace here. So as you inhale and then twist, I want you to keep anchored in your heels and try to keep anchored in both hips. And so your outside hip in particular needs to stay anchored, and you stay anchored in that seat bone by pushing through your heel. So as you inhale, as you come to center, and then twist the other direction, and as you reach down to saw off that baby toe, now I want you to make sure you're anchoring your outside hip, pushing your outside heel, and again, come up and rotate the other way. As you exhale, saw off that toe. Make sure your outside hip is planted and you're pushing through your heel. Okay, try that a few more times. This is not only a great stretch and teaching you to elongate your body, but it's also teaching you that to independently isolate that seat bone and push through that heel. This is a motion that happens quite a lot when you're riding. It is a way that anchors you into the saddle. When we're using our leg aids and our seat aids and turning, all that stuff's coming into play. So again, these Pilates stretches and exercises are so relative to riding because of the core strength and core articulation that you develop is so exactly what you need to be a good rider. Okay, so those are the three stretches I had for you this morning that are just kind of easy and fun and can give you some good information to translate to your riding. Now I want to show you my favorite part of Pilates altogether. I showed you some of these exercises before when I did a Pilates workout for you guys. But I really want to dial in on these rolling like a ball exercises because they are all about coordinating your abdominal muscles and balancing through your core. In riding, it is a sport that is very active and requires a high level of balance, yet you're sitting on your rear end. And so the reason I like these roll-ups is because as you're going to see, we're going to find coordination and balance using entirely our core muscles and really nothing else. We'll use a little impulsion too. And so the first one we're going to do is called rolling like a ball, and it's pretty easy. So with your feet at the front of the mat, scoot your seat towards your feet, and you can kind of just get in as tight a ball as you can. Reach over and grab your opposite ankle and then grab your forearm with the other hand. So just grab whatever you can that makes you into a ball. And now the first stage before we even try the rolling is I want you to simply lift your feet up on the mat and point your toes. Bring your chin down to your chest. I'm going to look at you when I'm talking so I can hear you. But I want you to place your chin to your chest. Having your chin to your chest as you roll back and as you roll back up will help you find your core balance and help you find your center of gravity. So the first step is, can you just hold your toes off the ground? So see, my feet aren't touching the ground. And can I just maintain balance using my core muscles? If you do nothing else but this, you're actually getting a good workout for your riding skills. But the main part of the exercise is that you're going to inhale and roll back and exhale as you come up and find balance again without your toes touching the floor. And you want to try to do this in a slow motion and controlled fashion. So like this, I'm going to inhale and go chin to chest. And roll back up and find balance. Now, I had to touch the floor that time. And I'm certainly no professional at doing these exercises. And some of these I have yet to master. And the balance is hard to perfect. You'll find that after you've done 4, 5, or 6 roll-ups, you're starting to find the point of balance. So let's just try that now. I want you to do, let's say 6 roll-ups. So you're going to feet off the floor, find your balance, chin to chest as you inhale and roll back. Keep chin on your chest as you come up and find balance. Again, chin to chest. I lost my balance. it's hard to work on these exercises and talk about them too. So let's try that a few more times. Chin to chest, roll back as you inhale, and try to do it in slow motion and with control. Exhale as you come back up, and chin to chest until you find the balance, and then repeat the whole thing again. Okay, so you can practice that. You'll find, like I said, do it 6, 8, 10 times. You'll get better at it every day. You'll find more and more balance. And just remember, every time you roll yourself back up and find that perfect balance, imagine how that is helping your riding skills in a tremendous way. And so, okay, that was rolling like a ball. The next rolling exercise I want to show you is a little bit more involved, but it's not very hard. I want you to, with your bottom kind of in the middle of the mat, bring your toes together and knees apart. And then with your hands together, I want you to dive right between your legs, come around and grab your ankles and pick your feet up off the ground. Suck your belly button in, chin to chest, and just hold this position. Just find the balance. Now, with your legs in this position, This is even more relative to riding. And the coordination and abdominal control that you will learn in this exercise will make you way more secure in battle. Also, we're going to work on a little bit of coordination here. So what we're going to do from this position is my feet are off the ground, and I've got my chin to the chest, and I've got a perfect balance. I'm going to clap my feet three times, roll back and clap my feet three times, and roll back up and find balance. So you're going to inhale as you roll back, exhale as you come back up. So it looks like this. One, two, three, back. One, two, three, up, and find balance. So again, one, two, three, roll back. One, two, three, roll up, and find balance. So continue on with this exercise. Try it five or six times until you get super coordinated, until you find that balance right when you get back up. The coordination of clapping your feet together just adds a certain rhythm, a certain challenge in coordination. Again, make sure you're putting that chin to your chest the entire time you roll back and up until you find the balance. Fun. I could do these roll-ups all day. I love them. Okay, so try that a few times. Again, try it every day. You'll find that your coordination and strength and your balance improves every single day when you do these exercises, and you'll start being able to imagine how relative they are to riding. So one more fun rolling exercise I want to show you. And this is the one that I can't quite do right because my knee doesn't bend that much. And so I'm going to just reposition here a little bit. And this is called the crab. And so I want you to sit cross-legged. And this position is very difficult for me. For one reason, I have a bad knee, but that's not the only reason. The other reason is after a lifetime of riding horses, most of which is at the professional level, but I started riding at a high level very young and developing those muscles, those adductor muscles that bring my knees together. For me, spreading my knees apart is really difficult because these muscles on the inside of your legs are, on my legs, are overdeveloped on the adductor side. And so the stretching out, the flexibility side is not very good. So this exercise really helps me a lot find more opening in my hips and more flexibility in my inner thighs. But for most people, sitting cross-legged is not as hard. So from the cross-legged position, I'm going to switch my legs so my bad knee is on the outside. I'm just going to grab the front of my toes with my hands. So my knees are kind of now in my arms, maybe in your elbows, maybe in your forearm. And from this position, you're going to bend all the way forward. And then we're going to roll all the way back to our shoulders, switch your feet, and roll back up to this position. So stretch, two, three, and inhale and roll. Switch the feet, come back and stretch. And again, roll. Come back in control and stretch forward. Now let me show you the full meal deal of this exercise. So if I get a little help and get up here, you'll see. So if you can, you're going to roll all the way forward until your forehead is down on the mat. And then from there, you're going to roll back, switch your feet, and roll back forward all the way onto your head again. I'm sorry I can't demonstrate that for you. But I wouldn't want to have to scream out in pain during this live broadcast. So again, the crab, grabbing your toes, flexing, stretching forward with your head to the mat, roll back, switch feet, pull yourself back up to the balance position with control, and then roll all the way up to your forehead. So that's called rolling like a crab. I like that one because of the flexibility, the hip openers here, and then you're still working on that abdominal control. So those are my fun Pilates exercises for you to try. I hope you'll practice them a few days in a row, and you'll be able to see, I think, how that could help your riding a lot to develop that kind of strength and coordination in your abdominals. So, gonna wrap this thing up now by going through your comments. And maybe I'll be able to determine if you actually tried this or if I've just been here and made a fool of myself all this time all by myself. So let's see where we are. Horsepower's getting down. Okay, that tells me you're at least starting good. Okay, I'm going to scroll back up to where we left off. Okay, there in the quicksand comment. And hi, Leah and Kelly. Glad you could join us, even if it was just a short amount of time. Stopped in to say hi. Howdy. We're on the trails in the Daniel Boone Forest. Wow, you're checking in on Facebook Live while you're trail riding. That's pretty good. Thanks for all the knowledge. Almost 50 days of daily doses of horsemanship. I can't believe it's been that long and we've done that much. And we're not done. So, thank you. Okay. Love you too. My body is not elongated. Well, that's what we're working on, right? It's good posture, strength in your abdominal core. All of that is related. Your horse really benefits. The more elongated we can be in our torso, the more you're lifting weight on horseback, the more appreciative it is. Of your good riding. With two artificial knees, the hardest part is getting down on the ground and getting back up. I hear you. I've got no artificial knees, but the older you get, that down and getting back on your horses, right? Okay. Fighting to clap your feet when rolled back is challenging. Yes. It's challenging your balance. It's challenging your coordination. And I like sort of the mental focus that's required. As you do roll up, you want to really focus on trying to make the motion very slow and controlled, so you're really developing. And I don't just, you know, grunt it back and grunt it up, but try to really make it controlled and defined, so you're really engaging those muscles and developing that coordination as well. Try too hard. These are great. Big thank you. I only clap my feet over my head twice before I'm catapulted forward. Yeah, you can't really hold that back position very well. When you're clapping your feet and rolling, you're kind of clapping on the way up. But the challenge is, if you could hold that balance long enough to clap your feet in the back position. But I don't know if you can. Thank you, Twyla. I hope you enjoyed those. I know you enjoyed them because we've done this together before. Difficult. I'm old and my vertebrae don't roll one at a time. I'll try though. Yeah, you don't get it. This doesn't happen without effort. I've already done a whole workout on this morning before this. So I do it every single day and I work hard at this, and it takes a long time to develop this kind of strength and coordination. And I'm nothing compared to the professionals that teach Pilates or professional dancers. So I love the rolling like a crab, with all those rolling ones. thanks for why you ran us, but you're supposed to be not just watching, but doing it along with me. But if you're out on a trail ride or at work, I get it that you can't. But try it when you get home. Just found out what bad I'm in. Saving this every day exercise. Good. Just write them down. Once you learn how to do them, just make a list, and it won't be hard. Oops. I agree with the knee thing. Two artificial knees. Nancy says, hard, but I can definitely see the fit for riding. I'm sure you can, Nancy. I know you. I know you're a really, really excellent advanced rider. And so as we learn to really ride that horse with our body, as you learn to be able to move in the horse's rhythm while maintaining a perfect core balance with that horse. Remember, riding is a synchronization of the center of gravity between you and your horse's centers. And so all of that is coming from the core. So very, very valuable. At the very least, it's going to give you a more secure seat in the saddle and that ability to recover when you get off balance. And the better and better you get at this, the more articulate you will be with your seat aids, the more you'll be able to absorb the movement of the horse in your body, in your joints, in your legs, hips, and abdominal muscles. So I could go on and on all day about how beneficial this is to riding. I need a mat. Hardwood floors are not friendly. No, don't do this exercise on the hard floor because your back vertebrae won't take it. It'll be uncomfortable, and then you'll know what it is to be a horse in an ill-fitted saddle. Almost every on the roll-ups, you're going to inhale as you go down and exhale through your mouth as you come up. So in general, in a lot of these exercises, you're going to breathe in through the nose for a count of four or five, and then in the mouth for a count of four or five. And almost always in these exercises, we're exhaling as we really engage and strain those abdominal muscles. So you're going to inhale as you rock back, and then exhale through your mouth as you come forward. Also, keep in mind on these rolling exercises, having your chin into your chest will really help you find your core balance and find your center of gravity. So, okay. This exercise is great for your hip flexors. Yeah, definitely, especially the roll-ups. Okay, I made it to the end. I answered my questions first, and then I got through my lesson. I can't believe I made it to the end, an hour and 20 minutes. Not bad. We had a lot of discussion prior to the exercise, and it's important and valuable information that we discussed. So I thank you guys for asking the questions. I saw we got up to over 100 participants here today. So that tells me there's still eyeballs out there watching. Tomorrow I'm going to have an arena lesson for you. And I'm not sure which one is in our lineup next for the arena lesson tomorrow. But I'm sure Mel will jump in and let us know. So let's see. Stuff's ticking away so fast. You need some impulsion, yes. Good. Glad you got a good goal for your exercise. So, again, I'm Julie Goodnight. My website is juliegoodnight.com. Everything I talked about today and in past daily doses is available on my website in one format or another, either written articles, videos, audios. Be sure to check out my audio podcast. Check out the membership program. You can have unlimited access to hundreds of videos and articles and audio recordings for just $9.95 a month. You can get a year rate even cheaper than that. And also, I have the interactive training curriculum, which is an online coaching program with me as your personal coach. And so you can find out more about that at the Julie Goodnight Academy. So check out juliegoodnight.com. And one more question about keeping horses disciplined. Oops, that just with not paying attention to other horses. Do you apply this when in paddocks yourself moving around? No. It is when you are actively engaged in handling the horse. The paddock is their own place. That's their herd. Now, do I defend my space and expect horses to treat me the same way when I'm in their herd? Yes. But that's where they're allowed to interact and do whatever they want. Once they're caught and haltered, game over. No more interaction until they're turned back out in that paddock. So I hope that clarifies for you. Again, I've written a lot on that subject, a lot of videos on that. So, thank you guys for joining me. I appreciate all the comments. I appreciate the likes and shares. Be sure to go to my website and sign up for the email newsletter. It's going to come out later today with the newest blog post about the foster cult that is on his way here from Oklahoma City to Colorado for foster training, and then he will enter into the adoption pipeline. So we'll be coming at you, bringing you lots and lots of content on his journey and information about how you can help horses in need. There's lots of them out there all over this country, and they need our help. So be sure to join us for that. Meanwhile, we're going to have an arena lesson coming at you tomorrow. So thank you guys for joining me. I'm Julie Goodnight. This has been another daily dose of horsemanship homework. Thank you. I will see you again tomorrow. You're welcome. How can you strengthen your left knee for mounting? I think the best things you can do is either get a mounting block or a big step and just step up and lift your whole body and then slowly step down and then step up and slowly down. If when you step down, you'll go down heel first, you'll strengthen that left leg even more for mounting. But it's that step up that's the portion that you need to develop in your leg. So you're welcome, everyone. I already said goodbye. I'm helpless. Hopeless. Not helpless. Hopeless. When somebody asks a question, I have to answer it. So no more questions. So I'm going to quit. Thank you, guys. Goodbye.